sound is a member, and it means that it is the term or the way that people wrote the name of their country and of themselves. When they wanted to speak about their country, they would write it and they would put an owl, which represents a letter of the alphabet, a loaf of bread, which represents a letter of the alphabet, and a city sign. And this is how they wrote the name of their country, which they called Kemet. This circle with the cross fixed at the end of the word lets us know that this word is the name of a place, or a city, or a place. So all words that have this picture at the end of it represent a place or something. This is then the spelling of Kemet. As I said earlier, Egypt is a Greek word, and they never used that term before. So we don't want to use it either anymore. So the pronunciation, the actual pronunciation of this is Kem, and this would be Kemet. The way we know that is from dialect of the language. Nature, it is true, is no longer spoken anymore. So one of the first questions that people ask is, well, how do you know how the word sounded, how the language sounded? Well, we know that from dialect of the language. For example, there is a living spoken form of a language, which today we just call Coptic for lack of another term, which is a southern dialect that was spoken up until very, very recently. And it is still the spoken language, the spoken liturgical language of the Coptic Christian Church in Ethiopia and in Egypt. So a few priests actually read their Bibles in the ancient Nile Valley language, and they read a dialect of it, a very late dialect, granted, but it is a dialect. Then there is another living dialect of the language, which is Wolof, which is the language which is spoken in Senegal, West Africa. And that language has been proven to be the same as Medinetra on all levels of the grammatical structure of the language. The people call themselves as you can see, the difference between this word and this word are the people. This word has people, a man, a seated man and a seated woman, and three strokes, which represent plurality. Three always represents plurality in the dimension. So this is what they call themselves, the Kemetiyu. Now, there are other words in the language to name the country and the people. For example, they also refer to their country as Tameri. Tameri means the beloved land, and that is a term of reverence, to call your land the beloved land, Tameri. They also call themselves Rimesh, which was another term that they used to name the people themselves, but that also was a different kind of term. However, the most technical term used in reference to the people and their country was Kemet and Kemetiyu. So this means then the black man written with a piece of burning wood. And it doesn't mean that the earth, the dirt is black, but it means that it's the people that are black. As a matter of fact, the dirt in Kemet is red, it's not even black dirt. Kemetiyu means the black people, very literally, the black people.
The ancient Egyptian. I've just come from a conference in Dallas. It was the best attended black conference since the Nile Valley Conference in 1984. We had an audience of at least 2,000. This conference attracted a tremendous amount of attention because there is a great battle going on in Dallas over the Ramesses II exhibition. Many people are filing in from all over the world to have a look at this, and blacks are completely excluded in the sense that they're supposed to have nothing to do with it. They're supposed to have no relationship whatsoever to that early Egyptian. And the Egyptian Minister of Culture, in fact, made a statement saying that he doesn't want to get involved, the Egyptians do not want to get involved in this black thing over here, because Ramesses II is beyond black or white. And in fact, he made the statement further that Africans have nothing to do with his Egyptian culture. Now, the point I made was that he is speaking the truth. We have nothing to do with his culture because he is not an African. It is very important to understand that. The Egyptian Minister of Culture today is not an African. It is like if ex-President Reagan got up to speak for the Native American. The Native American is not in Washington. He is very rare there. He is found in Central Mexico, Central America rather. He's found in South America. We have to understand that in relation to modern Egypt. You can go into Cairo and you can sit in a room as you sit here, and there are no native Egyptians. There are Egyptians, but they're modern Egyptians. Do not confuse the modern Egyptian with the native Egyptian who built the pyramids. As you go further down towards the south, even in the north itself of Egypt today, you can find a great number of black African people. But many people that you see in Egypt today are not native to the place. This is true of America. Many Americans are white. The Native American is not white. Many Americans are late Asiatics, like the Japanese, the Chinese, etc. The Native American may have had some element of Japanese and Chinese, but the Native American is not Japanese or Chinese. So we have to be extremely careful about that. In fact, not until 1830, as late as 1830, no one seriously in Europe doubted that the early Egyptian was a black African. The Europeans who had seen him, the Europeans who had entered that country, the Greeks, the first great Europeans, the Europeans who had defeated the Egyptians, the Europeans who had entered that civilization, made it quite clear they were dealing with black people. They said it again and again whenever there was necessity to say it. They made it clear in their documents. Herodotus said quite clearly, these are black-skinned people with woolly hair. When, however, in 1974 at the UNESCO conference, Sheikh Anthony Diop went to great pains to show that his melanin dosage test had been developed to establish that the melanin content between the derm and the epiderm showed clearly that the mummies examined in the Museum of Man were black-skinned. Abdullah, the Egyptian delegate, jumped up. Nobody else got so upset, except the Egyptian who is not native, jumped up and said, even if they're black-skinned, they're white. It was very important to him to say that. Now, I'm not attacking the Arab, because the Arab, in fact, joining with the black African, the Arabian type, that is, because 100 million blacks speak Arabic. Okay, don't get confused with people speaking Arabic and Arabs, because many people who are not Arabs speak Arabic, and the Arab script, for example, was created by an African, Abul Aswan. Okay, so I'm going to use the term Arabian type, because the Arab could be black or white, just like the Jew could be black or white. And in fact, many of the original Jews were black. It's the later Jews who were white. So we have to be very careful what period we are dealing with. Okay, now it is very important to understand why the concern. Why are we talking about Egypt? Why is it so important? Why does it always arouse such strong emotions? Nothing. Nothing arouses stronger emotion in academic circles today than the discussion of Egypt. Even in my university, when I was introducing black civilizations as a course and I included Egypt, history professors got up and said, why are you putting Egypt in black civilization? It's not supposed to be there. It's in Africa, yes, but it is not African. And That's valid. The fact that it is in Africa doesn't make it African, because there are parts of Africa today that are not controlled by Africans. Okay, so that you have, the fact that it is in Africa itself doesn't make it African, because it's open to the Mediterranean, it's open to Asia, and the argument therefore was that since black people are in Syria and cannot form civilization, those people who are on the borders invaded, came in and created the civilization and lifted the poor benighted black up into civilization. And that argument did not have any validity until the slave trade reached a certain point where the black was profoundly disadvantaged. He'd been excluded from everything, so that when they discovered that Egypt had had such a profound influence on European civilization, its science in particular, its philosophy, its all of its great concepts, the black could have nothing to do with it. Perhaps it's these people on the borders who came in and built this civilization. But when we go back to the pyramid age, and you will learn something today that is very astonishing, which I only became aware of in fact a few months ago in connection with the Japanese trying to build a pyramid, that we are not dealing with inferior blacks. We are dealing with blacks at the very top of the world. And the reason why we are going back is for two main reasons. One, we who come out of a shattered world can be made whole again by bringing the pieces of our heritage together. And secondly, it is because we can establish on scientific grounds that man is not inferior or superior, that his equality is not built in any biblical fantasy or liberal sentiment. It is rooted in hard historical realities. What we have in evidence before us is an overwhelming body of things that established that early Egyptian as African. Sheikh Antidiop, who appeared before the UNESCO conference in 1974, established after hours presenting a vast body of evidence showing the intimate interconnections and threads to inner Africa, showing that everything Egyptian is African. Its language in particular, which had been classified as Afro-Asiatic, Afro-Hamitic, Afro-Semitic, Afro-this and that, that it was African. For the first time in 200 years, a world body agreed that they could not argue with that anymore. The evidence was overwhelming. The Egyptian language was established as an African language. Those elements that came in much later, the invaders, the interlopers who introduced certain Semitic and Asiatic elements, those things did not alter the fundamental structure of the language. They were just superficial elements that came in later. Diop showed that the totems were African. He showed that the culture was African. Many of their rituals and customs, their beliefs, their ideas were African. And he showed the traces he could trace. He could go back into the heartland, the birthplace. And as Gerald Massey had shown, the word Africa comes from Afro-Ika, an Egyptian word meaning beginning. And do you know how it came to be Africa? When the Arabs invaded, it was changed to Ifriqiya, and then the Romans changed it to Africa. And so that is how we have Africa. Africa, in fact, is the only continent that ever named itself. Europe did not name itself. Europe comes from an African princess called Europa.
That we have a better understanding of who the ancient Kemetic people were and are, let's get on with the tour. Our first stop, Cairo, Egypt. As soon as we arrived in Egypt, we had a short rest and we were off to see the world's most magnificent structure, the Great Pyramid of Cheops. Our tour guide was Dr. Yosef Ben Johanan. With him is Dr. Asa Hillard and Dr. Leonard Jeffries, both distinguished historians, and Gil Noble, a TV producer out of New York City. Dr. Ben, our tour guide, has been doing research in Egypt for over 40 years. He has a PhD in Egyptology and has lectured at the Distinguished University of El Azhar, Egypt's most distinguished and prestigious university. We began the study tour with the Great Pyramid of Cheops because this pyramid represents the cumulative knowledge of the ancient world. The Great Pyramid of Cheops was erected almost 5,000 years ago. There are 2,300,000 precision quarried stones in its construction. Each stone weighs between 2.5 tons to 30 tons. It has been estimated that if all the stones in the Great Pyramid were to be cut into 1-inch squares and placed side by side, they would span a distance 3/4 around the earth. Its builders had a broad knowledge of chemistry. For an example, the mortar they used has not been duplicated, for it was paper thin between the stones. The orientation of the Great Pyramid is perfect. It faces true north, south, east, and west, with an exactitude unequaled by the builders of later times, and can only be duplicated today by specially trained men using special instruments. Early surveyors of the Great Pyramids detected the standard unit of which all its measurements are multiples. This unit is known as the pyramidal inch. The number of pyramidal inches in the sum of the four sides of the base is 3.6524, the same figure including the fraction that appears in the number of days in the year, 365.24. By using the height of the Great Pyramid as a radius, a circle can be drawn whose area equals that of the pyramidal four-sided base. It is called squaring the circle. The procedure is simple, but to be familiar with it implies knowledge of geometry and mathematics. Its use in architectural planning also implies a philosophical concern with using opposites, relating all elements to the whole, uniting the whole, and making a building a model of the universe. This harmony of properties is found throughout the Great Pyramid. The builders of the Great Pyramids knew the precession of the equinox, which requires, according to modern calculations, almost 26,000 years. The earth rotates with a movement called precession, which results in a slow westward shift of the equinoctial points along the plane of the ecliptic. This movement is similar to that of a spinning top as it loses speed, and it causes the polar axis to indicate a different point in space each day, requiring 25,827 years to complete a cycle and return to any given position. This data is obtained by adding the longitude of the diagonals of the base. Not only did they include the number of years in its construction, but they erected the Great Pyramid precisely where the star would appear at the completion of its nearly 26,000-year orbit. The Great Pyramid was also a giant sundial that indicated the precise dates of the solstice and equinox. It was the farmer's calendar, dividing the year into planting and harvest seasons, and probably regulating important agricultural activities, not only by the date, but by the hour. These practical purposes served by the Great Pyramid augmented its religious significance. It was a sacred symbol, not only for Egyptians, but for travelers from other countries as well. Awesomely magnificent in appearance, the pyramid was known by the educated people of all nations as a storehouse of knowledge. It is still listed today as one of the seven wonders of the ancient world. Not history.
Here, mind-blowing experiences start. You know, when you say religion started in this, in calculations, in a work I'm doing showing that the African use logic to create God as a concept in his mind. And that logic is no different than the logic he used to make the triangulation and the spherical dimensions to figure out these pyramids, and to use these to figure out the movement of the sun, the moons, the stars, in order to give us a calendar, and to make chemicals, and to make medicine, pharmacology. All of it came out of this African mind here.
He's into history. He's into those fields.
That's right. He's unavoidably practicing history.
Every mathematician who starts to work and writes down something that he calls the Pythagorean theorem, which was produced before Pythagoras was born, and not by Pythagoras, you know, even though he may think he's practicing mathematics, he's passing on images of history that affect the images of the practitioner. And that is true of almost every field, whether if it's a medical doctor who raised his hand and took the oath of Hippocrates, when we aren't even sure there was a Hippocrates,
right. Yes.
When it was really this gentleman, Imhotep, who designed the Step Pyramid, who is the true father of medicine. His name was termed Aesculapius, so your physicians then all raise their hand and practice history when they say, I swear by Apollo the physician and Aesculapius. And the very fact that many of them can raise their hand and take an oath to a person that they don't even know suggests that maybe they ought to practice both their profession.
And the beautiful thing about that last question of the so-called Hippocratic Oath, which claims to say is the hypocrisy of understanding the domination of Western culture, is that a living African genius, a vizier to the pharaoh, Djoser, in Hotep, became translated by the Greeks into a god of medicine and healing arts. Yeah. So the Greeks worshiped the African. And that's why it's important for us to understand this foundation in order to build for a future. Because art, architecture, medicine, literature, astronomy, mathematics comes out of this culture built by the Africans to others who raised it high. We have to do that if we're going to construct a true African future based upon African values and a mission in life dedicated to African interests, which all people have to do. If we can't expect others to do it, we have to do it for us.
You know, it's unique because my bachelor's and master's is in civil engineering, and I got a law degree, and I've practiced law for about 2 years. So I had this thing about multidisciplinary thing, you had to have a voice to be a professor. Now, engineering came from here. Triangulation and everything, mathematics, pi, and all that came from here. The first numbers, 1 to 8, came from here. When we go to the temple at Komombo, I will show you the engineering, the numbers, the system, where it came from. So that pharmacology, there's nothing you could practice. Computer science, you can have computer without mathematics, logic. You know, every discipline that you could think of, That's what the statement, nothing is new. You make transformation, but nothing is new, came from here.
Just give me a brief history lesson here. Which is the oldest of the three pyramids? There are three small ones in the foreground, and there are two small ones to the right. Just give us an idea of how and when they were built.
The first one, you see the one with the cap on?
Right.
The white cap. All of them had that marble cap. The first one, which is the tallest, even though it doesn't look so, this one in the middle seems to be tall. It's just smaller, but built on higher ground. The first one is of Khufu, all the fourth dynasty. Khufu.
The one nearest us.
No, the farthest one from
that's
us.
That's the tallest one?
That's the tallest.
The tallest.
It's actually the tallest, and it is the oldest. That's built by the father of these three men. The one Khufu, his son, the one with the marble casing on, is the second. That's by Khafra, the son of the one farthest from us. And this little one here, the third in height, is Menkaure, the son of the second one and the grandson of the first one. Now, the Greeks call the first one Khufu Cheops, Herodotus, when he came in, that's way later, in 450, that will bring us into the Persian period, because the Greeks took over in 332, so the Persians were ruling for 525, so that means Herodotus was here during the time of the Persian rule. The second one is Khafra, the son. By the way, when we see the down there, the Sphinx, it is Khafra's face that you're going to see. And that's the second one. And then...
That's where Khafra is buried?
Yes. Uh-huh. Not necessarily the mummy's there. Mm-hmm. It's robbed and taken away. Mm-hmm. But that one, the Greeks call Chephren. And the third one is Menkaure, the son of Khafra and the grandson of Khufu.
Now what about these little ones in the foreground?
Of the queens. They're queens and a few other dignitaries, but mostly queens and prime ministers are the best. But the prime ministers, for the most part, and other officers, are buried into what is called mastabas. We will show you. A mastaba is nothing but a rectangular shape thing. Originally, the kings were burying them, uh-huh. But then they start to go towards the pyramids.
All right. There's one other. You see, were you going to say something about the boat?
The boat house.
That's very important.
Yeah.
What is the boat?
Well, you can see the house near the pyramid in the farthest distance out
that
there.
Smooth area.
Right at the base. That is actually a housing for a boat that is 140 feet long. That is, it's called Khufu's boat. It was buried in a pit.
A wooden boat, really?
A wooden boat.
A royal barge.
And it's 140 feet long. Now, by comparison, you have Captain Cook's ship, the Endeavour that he was sailing on was 106 feet long. So you have a 140-foot boat in that, reconstructed from the lumber, and that was buried, it was disassembled and buried in this boat pit, and it's now been reconstructed so you can see what it looked like.
All right. In other words, they used to take this boat, disassemble it, pull it down, and then when they need, reassemble it. Not a piece missing. Wow. It run from 100 feet long to 4 inches long.
Yeah. Wow. Yeah. Now, this valley here is barren, there's nothing growing here. Was it like that when the pyramids were built?
Yes, sir. Akhet Khufu, the horizon of Khufu, except for the stones that they dug out and the wind that blows this sand back and forth, it is as it was.
All right, now, the Nile is not far from here. In the haze in the background is the city of Cairo, right?
Yes, a good way from here.
He's at Cairo.
A few miles.
Cairo. All right.
Yeah.
And the Nile is how far from here?
Figure 5-10 miles.
All right. And I guess the average person is going to look at this desolate area and say, why in the name of heaven would you start something that enormous out here?
But
why?
Notice one thing, though. This is the West, and everything is symbolical in East. This is the West Bank.
Yes.
This is where you go when you die. The sun sets in the West. So
that's
symbolically,
right.
This is the barren place where you make your final resting place. But you're going to, you will
rise again. And when you rise again, this will be, you will become, you, when you die, you're Osiris. But when you rise again, you will be Horus.
That's
just
right.
Like the sun rises again, but it rises in the east.
That's right.
So most of your living quarters, your temples, were built on the east side of the river. This is the cemetery. We are standing in a cemetery right now.
Necropolis.
The cemetery, necropolis. A necropolis is right over here on this side.
Necro is in death.
Yes. Yeah. Only the dead, except one exception, and the exception wasn't built. It was in Saqqara, where the Nile at once changed its direction. Mm-hmm. And so the people had to move from Memnefa to the high side, and it's the only place where the necropolis and the living quarters merged.
So this is a royal burial ground.
That's what it is. Yes. That's all
that
it is.
The royal cemetery. And what you do not see under the sand are tombs and temples,
burial
places. It's an enormous thing. One evening I had a chance to go in and out of this. It's an extraordinary thing. But Gil, what is important is the concepts that came out of this culture and civilization. They read the laws of nature. They were able to do what they did because they began to scientifically and systematically study the laws of nature, science, physics. And you see this development east and west bank reflects the laws of nature. The rising sun in the east, the setting sun in the west, the renewal of the life cycle. And so the Africans, it was very simple. If you understand the laws of nature that they operated on, you can see why they built this culture.
And you can understand, as we mentioned before, that everything was tied in spiritually and everything was related. There was no separation of church and state. Church and state was spiritually connected because you had to have spiritual development in order to rule.
You couldn't eat without washing yourself.
That's
right. You couldn't eat without saying a prayer.
And what was beautiful is that the whole society was built around concepts of law and ethical and moral principles that everybody was accountable to. The high priests and the pharaoh. Everybody was accountable to these laws and these ethical principles, and they're built into our culture, which we don't understand today in terms of the scale of justice, in terms of the whole question of eternal salvation, in terms of the question of the ma'at, in other words, the justice holding you accountable to a
the
principle of law,
of justice,
right, come directly out of the last judgment scene of the ancient Africans of the Nile. There's so much of the culture.
In the tomb of
we have a papyrus with the scale of justice on it. And it's called the scale of justice.
Is there a plumb line here on these? Is there any
sequential order? Just like they adopted in Washington, D.C., is the exact sequential order.
And these lines of the pyramid, are they pointing in one direction? No,
yes, sir.
True east, west,
northwest, north, south. Perfect.
Perfectly perfect. Northwest.
Not a fraction of a degree off. Like the other day, somebody came and make a measurement, and they said it wasn't the pyramids off, the wall went off.
That's why we have to restore and rescue and certainly take back the pyramids. The pyramids are so important to understanding the opening of the culture of the Nile. The pyramids have to be restored to African peoples because they reveal symbolically, because they reveal that strength and beauty that came out of this culture, that laid the foundation, that allowed the Greeks to rise, that allowed the ancient Hebrews to rise, that allowed other cultures to rise, that even inspired Islam to rise the way it did. Now, when African peoples tap back into this cultural system, they will have a new day in history.
You have seen the Sphinx at this point. And here is a view from a profile. The Sphinx have different kinds of tales spoken about it. In the first place, the word Sphinx is a misnomer. Sphinx is a female statue in Greece. And when the Greeks came here, they thought they were looking at a sphinx, a female statue. But in fact, as you notice, this is the head of a man. In fact, it is the head of the second pharaoh that built the second pyramid that you saw there. The first was his father, Khufu, otherwise the Greeks call him Cheops. The second is this man, Khafre, who the Greeks called Chephren. And the third, the smallest one, was Menkaure, the grandson of the first, the son of the father, this one. And it's the head of this African and the body of a lion. the wiseness of the man, and the strength of the man. And then there is the, right in front of it, you see an altar.
Yes.
And at the bottom of this altar, you equally see a stella called the dream stella. Mm-hmm. It is supposed to be a stella put there by Thutmose the IV. When he was passing, the Sphinx is supposed to be covered up by sand, and the Sphinx cried out to him, if you clear me away, I will make you a king of kings. And Thutmose cleared the Sphinx away, and yet later he became the king of Egypt. He was the son of Queen Hatshepsut, the only queen king in history. But learn more about the Sphinx, which the Arabs called Abu el Hal. When they came, they thought it was a kind of a devil, Abu el Hal. As a matter of fact, the street going down from here is called Abu el Hal Street, the Sphinx Street. It is said to be the nose was destroyed by Napoleon, who ordered his men to blow the face off with cannon fire because they looked like the African looks. And then again, there's a story that the Mamelukes, when they came, instead blew the face off. And then it depends on who's speaking. There are numerous stories of how they blew the face, but all of them blew it off because they didn't look like it's African looks. You could still see the lips. The nose is gone, the beard is gone, but you could still see the lips, who it is. Since they said that Africans got thick lips, of course, they're African with thin lips and thin lips, and thin nose or pointed nose, but there's no doubt that this largest of human sculpture, one piece is cut from that rock. Here was where the quarry was to get a certain amount of rocks for the building of the pyramids. And this was a pyramid. By the way, those three major pyramids you see and the other two small ones were not the only ones in this complex. There were 16. The Arabs, the early Arabs, used these stones for building of mosque and home of the wealthy. Mm-hmm. It was not until as late as Anwar Sadat, when it was outlawed, that you cannot take stones from the pyramid to build either mosque or homes of the wealthy. The Sphinx go back to the fourth dynasty. Khafra was one of the pharaohs of the fourth dynasty. What happened here is that these pyramids, at least the story of the Jews building the pyramids, in no condition could they have built these, because these are before the birth of the first Jew, Abraham. These go back to the old kingdom, before the coming of the Hyksos in the 13th dynasty. Abraham was born until the Africans here were already in the 13th dynasty. This is the fourth dynasty. This is what you see at the fourth end, up to the sixth dynasty. There are 72 pyramids. The last were built in the same dynastic period Abraham was born. Therefore, the Jews could not have enslaved, been working on a single pyramid in all of Egypt, not one pyramid. And these are the folklore. But notice you don't find this in the Bible. You don't find anything about the Jews building pyramids in the Bible. The Jewish Bible, the book of Exodus, said building cities and things. These were not in the city.
Leaving behind the great pyramids and Sphinx, we travel south by bus to see the step pyramids of Saqqara. On the way, we get a view of Egypt today. But no moment is wasted. Dr. Leonard Jeffries gives us a lecture on the origins of Egypt.
But you have to have an understanding and grasp of the past in order to appreciate your circumstances at the present time, and even more important, to prepare a future. for yourself. And unfortunately, the history of African peoples, which has been the most important history of any peoples on the globe, has been hidden from us. If we don't fully appreciate and understand that history, then we develop, as many of us have, an internalized concept of inferiority. The feeling that African people have achieved nothing, the feeling that Africa, the continent, has not been significant in the development of the human family, and that internalized self-negation produces a lot of the anti-behavior that we see manifest over and over again. I was trying to tell the youngsters today that it's important to understand the history, particularly the enormity of the African struggle in the continent of Africa, and also the African people's struggle out of the continent, because it is a source of not only pride, but it's a source of inspiration and a source of spiritual upliftment when we grasp the significance of what we've achieved as a people from the most ancient times through to the current times. It's important for us to have an overview to appreciate the enormity of the developments in the Nile, and also to appreciate the statement that Dr. Ben has often said, that Egypt represents the zenith of Nile Valley civilization. It is not the beginning of Nile Valley civilization. It represents the building up step by step through these decades, through the centuries, of the values of African peoples that reached its height in Egypt. But in order to appreciate that, you have to go south into Africa to find out the foundation upon which the great developments in Egypt relayed, and those foundations are in Nubia, south of Egypt, and even further south into Ethiopia, and even further south into Uganda. In fact, the Africans themselves say that in their histories, in the Papyrus of Hennepa, for example, which was one of the great books of the African people, that they come from the beginning of the Nile at the foothills of the mountains of the moon, where the god Hapi dwells. In other words, they saw their roots deep into the central areas of Africa, which we can consider that the birthplace of humanity and the cultural cradle of world culture. And as the Nile flows south into the Mediterranean, so the cultural movement was from the center of Africa or down the Nile, whichever perspective we want, to Egypt, and then off into the Mediterranean. Yeah, I think geographically,
what
areas
are we talking about?
Well, the source of the Nile is in the Great Lake region of Central Africa.
Would that be Uganda?
That would be Uganda, Kenya, Tanzania. Those were the central areas of the continent, and that's where the great watersheds of the African rainfalls were. From which the Nile flowed through the African continent, through Ethiopia, Sudan, and on into Egypt, 4,000 miles. So the Nile is one of the great rivers of the world, and it's not only great in terms of its ecological impact, meaning the overflow which fertilized the banks of the Nile, but it's also great as a cultural highway. And it was through that cultural highway that major events of the human family actually took place. We can date those events, because when we talk about an overview of African history, we need to go back into the myths of the antiquity, of the past. Because Africa is the cradle of humanity, in other words, the birthplace of humankind. And when we're dating that birthplace, by scientific measurements, we go back millions of years.
Finally, after about an hour's ride, we arrived at the Step Pyramid at Saqqara. This is a rendition of what it looked like 5,000 years ago. Dr. Asa Hillard gives us an overview of its time and its builder.
One of the things about this particular designer of the pyramid, Imhotep, is he's also known to the Greeks as their father of medicine. They changed his name as they did the names of many pharaohs, cities, towns, places, from Kemetic or Egyptian names to Greek names. And so the Greeks, according to Herodotus and others, changed the name of Imhotep to Aesculapius. And all your physicians today in the United States, when they take their Hippocratic oath, will swear by this physician who designed this pyramid. So he was a multi-genius in that he did not only architectural design and poetry and statesmanship. He was Secretary of State at the same time. And so here you had a person who mastered many, many disciplines. So just as this building represents a state-of-the-art technology in the 2700 BC, Imhotep himself represents the state-of-the-art in human thinking and has been seldom equal since that time.
Now, you said this was, tell me a little bit about this pyramid.
Well, it's built on, if you'll notice, there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 mastabas that you can see. And this is the burial pattern in pre-dynastic time. Used to dig a hole in the ground and bury the body, and then cover it with a slab of rocks called in the Arabic mastaba, which means simply a flat bench, usually rectangular in shape. And this pyramid is indeed rectangular in shape. But you get the pyramid effect by stacking mastabas on top of each other. But you still have the same function, just as this pyramid has a burial chamber, and there were two sarcophagi inside the burial chamber. There were other pieces of pottery, very little writing at all inside the pyramid. I guess that's most of what I want to mention.
What year was this pyramid?
2700 BC, 28th century BC.
So this is one of the earliest?
This is the oldest pyramid in the world. It's the oldest stone structure in the world. Mm-hmm. And this whole complex then represents a type of architecture in stone that is unlike anything that had ever been seen anywhere else in the world.
Mm-hmm. And who were the builders of this?
These were the native African people who built this, because you remember that we're in the first 12 dynasties still. In fact, this is in the third dynasty, so this is really in the Old Kingdom, which would be the oldest kingdom in the world. And at that time there, this is pre-heroic Greece. You know, for example, the heroic age in Greece is somewhere around 2000 BC. And so this civilization will function for another 750 years before there will be anything resembling a Greek, even in mythology. This places us well at the forefront of civilization. They were native people, they were black African people who did this work. All the carvings, paintings, and everything will verify that. In the fifth dynasty, means it comes after the building of the great pyramids, really the great three pyramids. It is a pyramid, even though it's hard for you to see it. It has collapsed because of probably the quality of the workmanship and the amount of time that went into it. It's important because it contains the oldest literature in the world of a religious nature, and it's called the pyramid text. Several pyramids around here had carvings on the wall of ancient religious ideas, thoughts, usually prayers, praises, things like that. These are collected together and they form something known as the Book of Coming Forth from Darkness into Light, or as some people call it, the Book of the Dead. This was all during the Old Kingdom. We're talking about a period back around 2500 BC. A little later, during the Middle Kingdom, the writings, instead of being on the walls of pyramids, because they stopped building pyramids during that period, the writings would be on the coffins. So there's a whole set of literature called the coffin text. You have pyramid text, coffin text, and then papyri, which together keep repeating the same messages, praises to God, prayers for things, offerings to the gods, and spells, and so forth. And it's that writing again that forms together a body of literature that dates back to approximately 5,000 years ago. In other words, it was in place at the founding of the Kemetic first dynasty in Kemet. So we have not only the oldest literature in the world, but what could be called the oldest Bible in the world. And indeed, we remember that Moses, according to Acts, the 7th chapter and the 22nd verse, was an Egyptian priest, learned in all the wisdom of Egypt. And of course, that meant he would have had to know what was on the walls of these pyramids. If Moses knew what was here, then we shouldn't be surprised to find that much of what's in Moses is exactly like what came out in the ancient Kemetic religion. The Ten Commandments are only 10 of 42 negative confessions. The creation story, you know, that would already have been found in the ancient Kemetic literature. And virtually all the symbols that would later be the Hebrews and the Christians were already in place before, in the case of the Hebrews, they're already in place before Moses, and they're definitely already in place before Christianity. So this then is the African foundation of the world's major religion, not just Christianity, but the foundation of all the religions in the world is centered right here at this spot. Mentioning here one type of literature, which is the book of coming forth from darkness into light, or the biblical texts that are much like the Bible. There were other types of literature. There were several different genres of literature in ancient Egypt. So it's the forerunner of all those things. It's the forerunner of the short story. It's the forerunner of the epic story. It's the forerunner of poetry. It's the forerunner of prayers and sacred praises. It's the forerunner of Bibles. It's the forerunner then of wisdom literature. And the wisdom literature that we're talking about would be like that that you find in the Bible, Songs of Solomon, which imitates in Psalms, Songs of Solomon, imitates such papyri as the sayings of Amenemhat, the teachings of Ptahhotep. You'll find both in terms of style and also in terms of content or substance that this material is all found right here. Nile Valley. They'll either be found here in some of these pyramids that we found on papyri, that we found on the coffin, or taken all together. And we have not even begun to exhaust that body of literature.
After spending 2 days in Cairo, we flew south to Aswan. Here, the majority of the population is Nubian. They are the direct descendants of the ancient pharaohs. They were happy to see us.
Thank you for having us.
They called us Nubians from America.
Of course, yeah, because we are same. There's no difference between us. Nubian American, Nubian Egyptian people.
Well, we are very happy about American Nubians here. We need to contact every year, you know, more than this.
Many of the women in our group bought Nubian outfits, and it became hard to tell them apart.
New Jersey. Rockaway, New Jersey. My name is Jerry Fletcher.
California.
Hey, you're from Oakland, California.
We were invited into their homes. Many hours were spent just getting to know each other.
That's the house. We're going to have a quick tea. There we go. She's my sister.
Oh, your sister?
Yeah. Hello, sister. Let's go.
Today, Nubia is 99% Islamic. When the Christians ruled Egypt, it was 99% Christian. But in ancient times, the Nubians worshiped and lived according to the very concepts and principles that are reflected in the temples and tombs along this Nile River. These houses still resemble those of 5,000 years ago. They keep water in vessels like these to keep it cool. Most of the rooms are open. It hardly ever rains here. This is where food is kept and prepared. We talk for hours. Like all Africans, no celebration is complete without a dance. First, some of the youth who came with us had to ride a camel.
I want to take a picture. That's always a camel.
Some of the villagers would follow us back to our boats. Nubian youth are good swimmers. I thought they would follow us across the Nile, but soon they turned back. It was getting late as we sailed back to our hotel along the Nile.
That's the sunset time.
The Nile is the longest river in the world. It was tranquil and peaceful. I put my hands in the river now and could not help but think of Langston Hughes. I remember the poem he wrote. Dusty rivers.